We've been going through these churches, and we have to do it week by week. I mean, we have to do a church a week because there's no way that you can compress them down because each one has its own separate character. Jesus is dictating these letters to John the Apostle. He's on Patmos as an exile. He's an old man. He's in his 80s at this point. He's probably around 95 AD, and he's a prisoner of Rome. And Jesus gives him the revelation, and he starts off with really what is the only actual relevant part for us, which is about the church. And so he speaks to each individual of these seven churches, which are in the western part of Turkey, called Asia, but the western part of Turkey. And we've gone through Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamos, and now we come to this church, Thyatira. And each one is getting a little bit more interesting, I would say. And each one of these churches, first of all, have historical relevance. They were real. I mean, they actually were these churches. They actually had these problems. And so what Jesus was saying to each one of the churches, the leadership in the churches, and those who read it to the members of the church, he meant it for them, and they had to correct if there was a correction to be made. And so we have that historical relevance. We have the fact that all seven churches received all seven letters, even though only one was directly written to them, because there's an aspect of each of the other six churches that's present in that seventh church, just as in our church. You know, and no doubt there's an aspect of all seven of these churches here in our own character, and there's certainly a contemporary relevance in the same way, and there's a personal relevance. We could take away a personal relevance. At the end of every single one of these letters, he says, "He who has an ear," and we've got two, so we can do it doubly, "he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches," and we're members of the church, and so what the Spirit is saying to me, right? And each one of us has to take it personally as well as corporately. So let's read through. This is Thyatira. I was going to start in verse 18. Coughing the crook. And to the angel of the church in Thyatira write, "These things says the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like fine brass. I know your works, your love, service, faith, and your patience. And as for your works, the last are more than the first. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you because you allow or you tolerate," your Bible may say, "that woman Jezebel," interesting, "who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and to eat things sacrificed to idols. I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, but she did not repent." Indeed, actually, the idea is in the present tense, "and she is not repented." Okay. "Indeed, I will cast her into a sick bed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation," note that, "unless they repent of their deeds. I will kill her children," not your children, he's nothing, "her children," those who are the offspring of that teaching. "I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and hearts, and I will give to each one of you according to your works. Now to you I say, and to the rest in Thyatira, as many as do not have this doctrine, who have not known the depths or the deep things of Satan, as they say, I will put on you no other burden, but hold fast what you have until I come. And he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and they shall be dashed to pieces like the potter's vessels. As I also have received from my Father, and I will give him the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." This is the most insignificant of the seven cities, and yet there's more print, there's more ink given to this city than all the others. And you know, we've talked about this a lot in the past, but the way to judge how important a topic is how much lineage the Lord gives to something. And so there's a lot that he's trying to get across here, and there's a lot that's happening. So let's try to work through a few of these things first. First of all, As I mentioned, if you can, you know, if you look it up in a map and maybe in your Bible, hopefully, you'll see that there's a route that's being followed as Jesus writes these letters from Ephesus to Smyrna to Pergamos, now to Thyatira, and then to Sardis and Philadelphia and Laodicea. It's going to kind of run like almost a circle, but a big loop. Okay, and each one of these, in addition to all the other things I said about his historical relevance and personal application, modern application to, you know, to our own fellowship and other churches around the nation and the world, there's a prophetic nature here of these churches. And I don't believe that in the first century that that those who were receiving it understood that, because how would they know history? But we can read it from the perspective that we're at, the position that we're at right now, and look back in history and see how the church in Ephesus really was much like the church in the apostolic age, and the church in Smyrna was the church in persecution as the emperors grew in power. And we can see how the church in Pergamos, we looked at that last week, it means objectionable marriage or mixed marriage or corrupted marriage, where the government and the church became one. We see Constantine in the, you know, the 4th century, et cetera, et cetera. And now as you look at Thyatira, it's very much like the church, the medieval church, really, from the 6th to the 16th century, and next week, you know, as we look at Sardis, very much like the Reformed Church, and the church in Philadelphia, much like what's called the Missionary Church, or the church from really the 1700s up until the 20th century or so, and then the church of Laodicea. So here we are. And that doesn't mean we're all Church of Laodicea. My point is, you can see the prophetic line. And we're going to go through each one of these churches and maybe on a Wednesday night then kind of bring it all back together. I'll just drop some breadcrumbs that way along the way, but we'll do it in some detail when we get to the end of this on a Wednesday night. Okay, so this is a church, or a city rather, that was not significant for really much of anything. You know, some of these others we've seen in terms of being the capital of the Western capital of Rome at that time, or emperor worship, things like that. You didn't have that in Thyatira. I mean, those things occurred there, but they weren't known for that. But what they were known was for its industry, not industry like we know industry, obviously, but you know, the crafts and whether it was, you know, fabrics or leather work or, you know, things like that. So actually, one of the things that Thyatira was very famous for was this purple dye. You could get this purple dye in one of two places. One, a tree, I forget the name of, and the other, a snail. I love these kinds of things. Like a snail that, you know, if you squeeze it the right way, a certain purple dye would come out. Who discovers these things? Like, who's the first person who ever drank milk? You know, that kind of thing. Who had the idea, like, hey, let's try this? You know, and who had the idea, like, you know, did they eat the snail? And someone said, man, you're purple, you know, or what? Or like, squeeze it, like, hey, look at that, you know. We can make a business out. Honey, bring your skirt over here. Let's dip this. Like, who does that kind of thing? But anyhow, someone discovered if you squeeze snails, you got this purple dye. Actually, you know, if you remember in Acts chapter 16, when Paul and Silas, you know, they end up in Philippi, the first believer there was Lydia, who was basically a sales rep from Thyatira. She was a seller of purple. And that was a very important, very expensive dye, because that was a sign of royalty. It was very, I mean, make a lot of money. It takes a lot of snails to squeeze, you know, to get enough dye to make things purple. So anyhow, but one of the things about the city of Thyatira is that that's where the whole idea of trade guilds began. We don't think of trade guilds unless you're a history person, okay? If you're in a union, or if you've been in a trade union, you understand the idea of a trade union. And if you understand some of the history behind it, in the earlier times in our country, we had trade guilds, which became trade unions, or in Europe, they had trade guilds. Trade guilds started in this idea in this city of Thyatira. And the idea was that you couldn't, you know, you might be a member of the, you know, local 666 of the Snail Squeezers Union or something, okay? The Snail Squeezers Guild. And there were, you know, leather makers and carpenters and stonemasons and those guilds. You could not work. You could not work unless you were a part of the guild. Okay. Sounds like a little arm wrestling, but okay. But now the problem is, this is a pagan land. And Christianity has come in. The gospel has come to Thyatira, which brings up the question of how. You know, some would say, well, maybe it was a church plant started out of Ephesus to Smyrna, Pergamos, and Thyatira. It could be. It could be Thyatira. It could be Lydia. Maybe she came back with the gospel and the church began as a result of her testimony. Don't know. But in any event, there's a church here now. And now there's a problem because you're a Christian. And when you go to the meetings for the guild, and you have to go to the meetings for the guild, the meetings are dinners. Sounds good. But the meetings, the dinners, involve pouring out wine to the pagan deities, sacrificing meat to the idols, then eating it, then getting involved with immorality and all kinds of perverse, you know, orgies and things like that. You say, well, I can't do that. I'm a Christian. Well, then you're not a part of the guild. Well, I got to make a living, don't I? I mean, the man's got to eat, doesn't he? Do you? So it brings up this really difficult situation for the believers in Thyatira. And that's an important setting as we go into this, because that was a major problem for the believers. It's still a major problem. You know, we don't think of people pouring out wine to pagan deities or eating meat sacrificed to idols. That's not an issue for you and me today. But you know what it's like. Hey, we were just told about all this Christmas stuff. Christmas is coming. And maybe it's the office party. You know, and you say, well, I know what happens at the Christmas parties. I don't want to go to the office Christmas party, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's all going to be this, and, you know, and everybody gets weird, and, you know, and they're saying, yeah, you're such a holy roller. Come on, man, just come. And you say, oh, well, one beer, I'll be able to evangelize. The one beer evangelistic, you know, movement, right? And so whether it's that or it's a part of the team that you're on or the club that you're involved in, whatever it may happen to be, something always causes us to feel as if I need, that's a very difficult word, I need to compromise. God knows. He understands. Right? That's what we tell ourselves. And, I speak as one, I was in sales for many years. I know what it's like. To say, I don't want to look stupid here, you know. I don't want someone to think such and such or that about me. So, you know, sure, I'll have that or I'll do that or, you know, laugh at that joke. And there are limits, right? You set limits for yourself. No, I'm not going to go to that joint. I'm not going to do that, you know. But there's certain things that we allow in our lives sometimes. And don't be too sure or don't be so sure that compromise that we've begun there is all that different from what's happening here in Thyatira. Because it's the beginning of a compromise. There's a path, right? And as we take that 1% off of that path, the longer you stay on that 1% off or 2% off path, the further we are from the truth. And unless we repent, that's where Hebrews 6 and some of those other very difficult passages come in. Now, some of you are thinking, wait a minute, I thought that once saved, always saved. Don't you believe in eternal security? Of course I do. Don't you believe that you're saved forever? I know I am, because I'm walking with the Lord. I've received the gift, and I've not denied Christ. I continue. But be careful. Walk with him. Okay, so I don't want to beat up that one too much right now. Because ultimately there's a snare, if we're not careful, that'll kill us. And you know, the Lord is a loving Father. We can read in other parts of Scripture where he allows so much in our lives, and he continues to say, repent, you got to stop this. You got to stop it. You got to come back home here. And if not, he'll take us out. He'll take us out of this life, out of this world, if we won't repent sometimes. And then there are people who go to their grave unrepentant. Okay, so who do we think we're dealing with? I think that's the real question. Because when we compromise, and that's really the issue that's going on here, there is this person who is, you know, he says Jezebel calls herself a prophetess. We'll get to her. Who's seducing, and that's a spiritual idea. This woman seduces them into this adultery. The only time you'll ever find the word adultery in the book of Revelation. You'll find fornication used many times, but adultery, and it speaks to the idea that we are just what we sang. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we're to be a bride pure and undefiled waiting for our groom, right? But to go off and to do those other things is to commit adultery against our bridegroom. So this compromise issue is an important one, because usually when we compromise, I would say all the time when we compromise, we're really talking to ourselves. There's a lot of self-talk that's going on, and we're telling ourselves it's okay. We're telling ourselves God understands. We're ranking up our theology as we go along. And so the first question is, who are we dealing with? Well, he says right here, we're dealing with the one who is the Son of God. He is the Son of God. It speaks to his nature. Many times Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man, actually more than he referred to himself as the Son of God. And we think of him as the Son of Man very often. We like the Son of Man idea because he has the nature of a man. Just as much as he's the Son of God, he has the nature of God. But we really like the Son of Man idea because I can relate to him, my Jesus. Years ago, there were so many t-shirts that Jesus is my homeboy. No, he's not. He's not my homeboy. He's not my BFF. He's none of those things, or whatever you call it nowadays. I don't care. But the point is, he's not that. He is Almighty God. And yet, he's the Son of Man. He's fully man. But we like the Son of Man idea because he's cuddly then. And we like to sit with him because he loves us and he forgives us and he understands everything about us. And so we use that to justify to ourselves. You're all thinking, man, you're a mess. No, we're all a mess that way. We all confuse ourselves if we're not careful. Son of speaks of the nature of someone. So he's Son of Man in that he's the Son of Mary. But he's the Son of God in that he's from the Father, Jehovah. And he is Jehovah. And it's difficult to comprehend. It's impossible to comprehend. We accept it because that's what the scripture tells us. But Son of, just like when he talks about James and John, and he calls them the sons of thunder. Well, it gives you a pretty good idea what they were like. I mean, they sound like a motorcycle gang, all right? No offense to you, but if you ride a motorcycle, what I'm saying is they sound like rough dudes, because they were. Son of speaks of character, of where a person comes from. When really, I encourage you sometime, go back to John chapter 8 and read Jesus' exchange with the Pharisees. And he calls them the sons of perdition, the sons of the devil. He says, you're just like your father, the devil. He's a liar from the beginning. When he speaks, he lies. He's been a murderer since the beginning. That kind of colors the idea. You get an idea how hot this exchange really was. They're the sons of perdition. That gives you an idea what they were really like. We're sons of, too. In fact, right? Doesn't John say that in the Gospel of John, chapter 1? He came to his own, but his own received him not. But to all who received him, to all who believed on his name, if you've received Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you believed on his name that he paid the price for your sins, then he gave us the right to be called sons of God. Your Bible may say children of God, but it comes from the Greek technion. We're sons of God. We're born again by his Spirit, so we're sons of God. It speaks to our nature. We have two natures now. I have the son of John, the nature of John, but I also have the nature of Jesus Christ living in me. You have the nature of you living in you, but you also have the nature of Jesus Christ living in you if you know Christ as your Savior. Okay, let's move on. Who are we dealing with? The Son of God, whose eyes are like a flame of fire. What does that mean? He sees everything. He sees everything. Later on, he's going to say, I know, right? And we've been looking at that in every single one of these letters. I know your works. I know your love. I know, right? And he's going to say that here. He sees everything. He sees everything, not just that we do. That's kind of thinking like we see a friend or we see, a child or, our parents see us or something as seeing something we do. No, he of course he sees that. And of course he sees what we have done. He also sees what we've not yet done. And he also sees what's going on in our mind and our heart. He sees that, even that, and that, and that. He sees it all. His eyes are like a flame of fire. He sees everything, and his feet are like fiery brass, fine brass. What does that speak of? First of all, steadfast. firm and brass judgment. Okay, so his eyes see, and he's the only one who has authority to judge. This is who we're dealing with. So when we compromise, as he's talking to the church in Thyatira, when we make those compromises, let's understand who we're dealing with. In our self-talk, he understands that conversation. He hears that conversation. We're really talking to him. We're really saying, look, just stay here in the car. I'll be back in a couple hours. You know, just stay here. Why don't you stay in bed? I'm going to watch this movie. You know, or whatever it may happen to be, whatever the compromise happens to be. I'm not saying movies are sin. That's not what I'm saying. It's what the movie is. Whatever the compromise is, he sees that. He sees our motive. He knows our thoughts. You say, wait, you know, this is, John, some of the stuff I've heard you say over the last weeks have been okay, but this is coming across like almost harsh, man. I mean, like, this is tough. Yeah, I know. But I didn't say it. He did. I thought he was my friend. He's the son of man. He's like soft and cuddly, and he's my friend. He didn't say that. Yeah, he did. Didn't he say it in the Gospel of John? He said, no, you're my friends. And he put a condition on it. If you do the things I say. Oh, that's different. Right. He's saying, stay in the path. Do the things I tell you to do. I've given you a new law. To love one another. And to put me first. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, and your neighbor as yourself. And from this hangs all the law and the prophets. Now follow me. He's never stopped saying, follow me. I understand that none of us has arrived, but let's understand who we're dealing with. He says, I know your works, I know your service, I know your love, I know your patience, and these things are good. He's commending them for that. He says, and I also know that the last things are more, the last things you've done are more than the first. It's interesting when you look at that prophetically, or I should say historically, that as the church has grown, regardless of what type or what flavor or what character, personality, however, whatever word you want to use, of church we're talking about, the works that have come out of it. I mean, think of, you know, the Presbyterian hospitals, the Lutheran hospitals, the Methodist hospitals, you know, the St. Jude, you know, you start to go down the list, they have grown and grown and grown and grown and grown. You know, the Buddhists aren't building hospitals, right? It's been the Church of Jesus Christ. And in many cases, it's Judaism that does it. He's saying, I understand your works are more than the first. I give you credit for that, but I have a few things against you. There are a few things that we need to talk about. And you get the hint, and I'm only going to suggest this. It's up to you to decide, but I think that as you read it, you'll get the sense, or read it closely, you'll get the sense that while in the other three churches, he was speaking to the leadership of the church, including everybody else, here it's as if he's speaking to the remnant in the church who love the Lord about everyone else who has followed the teaching of this other person about compromise, okay? Only a suggestion. But he says, I have a few things against you. He says in verse 20, you allow or you tolerate that woman Jezebel. You tolerate. And we don't need to get into all the stuff that we, you know, as Christians, we love to talk about today, which would be right to get into, about tolerating, you know, tolerance and all that, and what people expect out of the church and tolerance and all that, because it's all been turned upside down. But he's not turning it upside down. He's saying, you know the truth, and you know the right thing, but you tolerate. You allow this poison to come in. That's what you've done, he's saying. You allow that woman, so there must have been a woman, you allow that woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, you allow her to teach and to seduce my servants, Christians, to commit sexual immorality and to eat things sacrificed to idols. What was she doing? Well, the suggestion is that she was saying, look, everybody has to make a living. Everybody has to eat. It's okay to go to the guilds and be a part of the guilds. It's okay to be a part of the pouring out of the wine and the eating of meat sacrificed to idols. It's okay. It's okay to do those things and even to hang around later on because everybody's got to make a living, don't they? You got to eat, don't you? So it's okay. God understands And he's going to talk later on about those who teach the deeper things of Satan. You know, and I've not seen it around here for years, but I know it goes on in a lot of churches. The deeper truth club, you know, the people who are saying, you love Jesus, but you know, there's more. Let me tell you more. Those people are really dangerous. I haven't heard it around here. I'm not superstitious, but I shouldn't have said it. But but be on your guard. That's why, you know, we always say, be Bereans. We try to teach through the Word of God so that we know the Word of God, so that when we hear someone say something that isn't in the Word of God, we can say, and that's anathema. Right? Doesn't Paul say that in Galatians? If anybody brings any other gospel to you other than the gospel of Jesus Christ, they are anathema. Let them be accursed. Then he says, and I'll tell you again. If anybody brings another gospel to you, you just told me, I'll tell you again. If anybody brings you another gospel, even an angel from heaven, like Moroni, you know, or something like that, let him be accursed. That's how strongly God feels about this. You have a woman there, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess. Now, apparently it was a woman. Now, the question of whether her name is Jezebel or not is, you know, you can read the commentators, and a lot of people will say, no, he's just probably using that as an allusion. Maybe. Or maybe her name really was Jezebel. I don't know. Yes, I've done a lot of, you know, I haven't met, and I hope I don't today now after I say this, but and if I did, I'm sorry. But I've done a lot of baby dedications over the last 16 years. I've never dedicated a little girl named Jezebel. I've never dedicated a little boy named Judas, right? It's because people don't, you know, Christians don't associate that as good. And so, but maybe that was her name. I don't care. But, you know, I think enough of us here understand who Jezebel was. Let's do a quick review. After the kingdom of Israel split after the death of Solomon, as time went on, the most wicked king that Israel, northern kingdom, had ever seen was Zimri. And he had a son named Omri who was more wicked than his father. And then Omri had a son who was more wicked than him, who was Ahab. And a treaty, basically, was established between, really, Omri and Ahab, and Ethbaal, who was king of the Sidonians, you know, up in Sidon, up in the north, that Ahab would marry Ethbaal's daughter, Jezebel. So Ethbaal was a king of Sidon. He was also a priest of Baal. And you know, we've been through a lot of Old Testament studying here over the last year, especially, you know, we've been through Joshua, the Judges, you know, 1 Sam. And you know, we see how Baalism is around a lot. It's like, well, it was just introduced? No, it was introduced with greater strength than ever before in the northern kingdom when Jezebel came on the scene. And what she did is that she began to intermingle the worship, this pagan worship to Baal, you know, the god of success, the god of, you know, the rain and success and all those things. And also Asherah, which is a very immoral, filthy thing that we won't have to go into. But and she introduced that. You say, well, okay, Ahab was wicked, but what's with Jezebel? Well, actually, when you study them, you know, you read about from 1 Kings 16 to 20, 2 Kings 9, I believe. You read about Jezebel and Ahab, and you really get the sense that Ahab was like a whiner. He you know, not real strong, not much of a backbone, kind of caved. As wicked as he was, he caved to Jezebel. She was the one who really, you know, whether you say wore the pants or whatever you want to say, she was the one who was leading things. How did that happen? Men, how did that happen? Because he was weak spiritually. The only way that ever happens is when the one who is to be the spiritual leader is weaker and allows those things to happen, and something wicked can occur. Well, how did it happen in the kingdom? Because she had that much strength. And of course, you know, we think of the things that happen and all, and briefly, you know, that's the time of Elijah. And finally, the challenge, you know, we're all familiar with what happens on Mount Carmel, you know, where Elijah lays out this challenge to the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah. We always forget about them. There were 850 that were eating at her table. She was supporting, the northern kingdom was supporting them. And he challenges them to determine who is the Lord and for all the people. If Baal is God, worship him. If Jehovah is God, worship him. And they set up the, you know, we're not going to go into it, but Elijah lays out the challenge. How long halt ye between two opinions? When we think of halt, we think of stop. But halt means crippled. How long are you going to stand crippled between two opinions? That's what compromise will do to you. Because when we're compromised, we're crippled. When we start to walk off the path, we're crippled. And we're walking the wrong way, but we're crippled. We know we're not on the right path, but the further we go, the stronger we kind of get, and we're more determined to continue to go that way unless something changes our course. Well, so that happens in Israel. Now we're looking at something that's happening 1,000 years later, and this is this woman Jezebel, whether that's her actual name or not, who calls herself a prophetess. And those things happen in churches where people appear in the scene. And we've had a few things happen over the years. Nothing happening now that I know of. Where someone seems to think themselves a prophet or a prophetess. All the nonprofit organization jokes aside, you know. But, you know, where you have to say, you are not the high priest or the high priestess around here. You know, there is one way, his name is Jesus Christ, and if you're not going along with it, that's the door. And how does that happen in a church? How does that happen that a person rises up with that much influence? And it always, in one way or the other, boils down to people who don't know the word and leadership who's not strong, who can't spot it and deal with it and are unwilling somehow to deal with it. So you have this woman, Jezebel, calls herself a prophetess, and she seduces my servants into immorality and sacrificing to idols. That's what she was doing. She taught that it was okay to engage in those things. And we look at the church today. Sexual immorality is rampant in the church in America and around the world today. It's rampant. There's so much that we've allowed in because the culture has so affected the church. The church is supposed to affect the culture, but so much of the culture has affected the church that we allow those things. We think twice sometimes before we just say to someone that we know well, hey, you know, man, it's not right to be living with your girlfriend. Or, hey, you know, it's not right to be sleeping with your boyfriend. We think twice. Why are we thinking twice about that? Now, maybe we should think about how we're going to approach the topic. But that we allow it. And quite honestly, that's one of the problems with large assemblies. Because leadership can't spot all those things, doesn't know all those things that are happening in people's lives. It's up to each one of us to be walking with the Lord and to be, you know, involved in other people's lives. That's why home fellowships are important. You know, but you look at the church in America and around the world today, even since June and the whole, I'm not going to drag it, you know, around again, but, you know, the whole same-sex marriage decree from the Supreme Court. Well, now, so churches are thinking, okay, well, how do we work with this? How do we accept this? No, we're not to accept it. I mean, the law is the law, but our responsibility is before God first. He's the one we follow. We are to love all sinners. We are to love all who because he loves them, but we are also to stand first behind our King and our Savior, Jesus Christ, right? And to administer the medicine, the gospel, to them. And yet the church continues, and we can watch it happening in our society, we can see it happening around the world, we can see it happen throughout history, where the church has caved, and as it's caved, wickedness has risen up even more and more. She taught that it was okay to be what we would say, like the world. Rationalizations. We use rationalizations all the time. And he said, I gave her time, verse 21, to repent. You know, God gives time. Even if you go back to the Genesis chapter 6, God says, my spirit will not contend with man forever. He says, because his thoughts are only wicked all the time. That's pretty complete. Only wicked all the time. He says his years will be 120. He's not saying man's only going to live to 120 years old at that point, because people lived a lot longer. He's saying there's 120 years left. He's giving time. He's giving time for repentance. He's giving time for this to end. He gives time to America. He gives time in churches. He gives time in our personal lives. And you know it, and so do I, where he whispers to us when we're reading his word, and he goes, you know this is wrong. You got to correct this in your life. You know it's time to stop this. Or you know this relationship is going the wrong direction. Or you know that you're spending too much time over here and you're leaving the things of God. You know that's wrong. And he whispers, and then he speaks. Sometimes he shouts, until I don't believe it's ever the Father's will to lay us out publicly. It's his will to correct those things privately. But he'll do, just as a parent, a good parent will do what they have to do to get their child to walk right. And so he says, I've given her time, but she's unwilling to repent. And therefore, he's laid out the decree of what's going to happen. He says, I will cast her on a sick bed. Whether it's literally a sick bed, a lot of people debate it, possibly, in light of what she was involved in. And this is where it gets very interesting in verse 22, because it's the first of the seven letters. And this, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea all bear this character. He says, I will cast, he says, those who commit adultery with her, I will cast them into great tribulation unless they repent of their deeds. There's a suggestion here, and I would suggest to you, it's more than a suggestion, it's what it is. This church system exists today. This church system existed in the first century and has existed up until today and will continue until Jesus Christ returns, until the great tribulation happens. And those who do not repent will end up, because they're not following Christ, they don't want Christ, they will end up in the great tribulation. And look, I realize that I'm in southeast Pennsylvania, and so probably a half or two-thirds of the people in this room have come out of Roman Catholicism. And this Thyatira is very much like, and we'll get to it, some Wednesday night, is very much like the Roman Catholic Church. The Mass that happens, not just every Sunday, but every day in many Catholic churches. The unbloody sacrifice of Jesus Christ in the host, in the Mass. That's heresy. It's heresy. And yet it's a system that continues to this day and will continue until the tribulation. Now, I'm not a Catholic hater. Somebody think, you mean all Catholics don't believe? No, I didn't say that. I know lots of Catholics who believe. And if you come from a Reformed background, Protestant, Methodist, Lutheran, whatever it may be, don't get too huffy, because we're going to talk about Sardis next week. And he'll say to them, you have a reputation of being alive, but you're actually dead. So that's not cool either. All right, so this system, each of these four churches from here on, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea, all speak to the return of Jesus Christ. He says, unless they repent, I will send them into great tribulation, the great tribulation. If you have NIV, it says, I think, intense suffering or something. It's really in Greek, King James, New King James, NASB, it's all the great tribulation. Okay, and I will kill her children, not your children. He's not speaking of the true believers. He's saying those who have adopted that doctrine. I will kill them with death. What does that mean? We looked at that before in these other churches. The great white throne judgment. Because they're not believers in Jesus Christ, they will be raised and they'll be judged according to their deeds and cast into the lake of fire. That's the second death. I will kill them. That's a spiritual death with death. In other words, spiritually. And the churches will know, verse 23, that I am he who searches the hearts and minds. He knows everything about us. I will give to each one of you according to your works, to you, he says. In other words, he's speaking to the true believers, and he will. May we never forget that. because there's great hope here. Look what he says. I will give to each one of you according to your works. He says, whether we're talking about Matthew 25 and the parable of the talents, or Luke 19, the parable of the minas, they're a little different from each other. They seem the same, they're a little different. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of the way we've lived as believers. We've received salvation as a gift, a free gift, but we'll receive reward on the basis of how we lived. And those who have lived according to the way he's commanded us to live, we will rule and reign with him. That's what the Bible tells us. That's what Jesus has said. That's what Paul the Apostle says. That's what Peter tells us. We can read that throughout the New Testament. And I would say you can read it in the Tanakh too. And he says, only this, verse 25, just hold fast what you have until I come. They were in a desperate situation. Now there's no hint of persecution against them here. Just like in Pergamos, there was no hint of persecution like there was in Smyrna. But like Pergamos, it was a situation where when the devil can't intimidate, he infiltrates. He's infiltrated and they've compromised and they're going off and they're doing these other things. And he's saying, don't go that way. Don't listen to that kind of teaching. Stay the course. Hold fast. Remember what he values in Ephesus. Is love. He says, I have this against you. You left your first love. Remember the height from which you've fallen. You know, repent and return to these things. To Smyrna, he says, I give you nothing to do except just be faithful until the end. To Pergamos, he says, stand fast. He says, here, hold fast to what you have until I come. He talks about how Christ is coming and he's going to rule the nations. And he's saying in this, and we will rule and reign with him. There are those, and there are many. There are many in the body of Christ in America today who are teaching another gospel. There are many in the body of Christ today who are saying all kinds of things, that we are allowed to do all kinds of things. And that adultery, fornication, divorce, you know, that's not biblical, that we would say is not biblical, all these things are okay. He says, no, it's not. I'm not saying he's not a forgiving God. He is. He paid the price for all of our sins. So don't mistake what I'm saying. But Jesus says, come back, hold fast. Hold fast and walk this path until I come. We have it easy right now. It's not going to stay that way in America. All of our money, all the equity in our homes, all that stuff will do nothing for us when the persecution really comes, and it's probably not that far away. Hold fast. Hold fast against compromise. Hold fast to Jesus Christ. That's what he's calling us to. Let's stand together. Lord, we thank you for your great love for us, Lord. We thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for the good news, Lord, the good news that you paid the price for our sins. The good news that by looking to you, we can be saved. By choosing to believe that you rose from the dead, you paid the price for our sins, and you rose from the dead, that we can be born again, Lord. That all of our sins are forgiven. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for sending Jesus Christ for us. Lord, continue to pour out your Spirit upon us. Equip us for the days as they get darker, that we would walk with you, that we would honor you with our lives, with our words, with our thoughts, with our motives, Lord. And right now, Lord, in this room, anything that we need to repent of, anything that we need to lay aside, any sin that hinders us, Lord, to lay it aside so that we can keep our eyes on you and run the race that you've called us to, Lord. We hold fast to you, Lord Jesus. We love you because you're the only one who ever could have done that for us. And we thank you for heaven ahead, for the kingdom ahead, and all that we'll have with you forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen.